In this video, we're going to focus on two specific synthesis techniques, sample-based synthesis and wavetable synthesis. There are a lot of different ways to create sound, and categorizing these ways to create sound, though sometimes imperfect, it's a good way for us to figure out how we want to approach our own synthesis. Conceptually, sample-based synthesis is a good entry point to understand synthesis because we generally get the idea that we can record a sound and play it back when we want to. We do this almost daily when we queue up songs on our phone, computer, and while in sampling synthesis, we're generally not playing entire songs. The concept is straightforward. So here's a definition of sample-based synthesis, a synthesis technique in which sound is created by playing back recorded samples. Since we're playing back audio files, sample-based synthesis allows us to get sophisticated sounds very quickly and with relatively little processing power. But sample-based synthesis takes up a lot of storage, and we need a place to put all of those recorded samples. And depending on the audio quality and number of samples we have, this could be a significant amount of space. We call many of the synthesizers that use sample-based synthesis simply samplers. Getting into the whole history of samplers isn't the goal of this video and would likely take way more than one video, but let's make sure we hit a few main ideas. One of the earliest pieces composed of samples is The Expression of Zar by Halim Eldab, an Egyptian composer. Many times when we talk about the start of sample-based synthesis, we talk about Musique Concrète out of France after World War II, repurposing the wartime technology for expressive means. But Eldab's Expression of Zar predates Schaeffer's work by 4 years. Eldab took samples of a Zar ceremony in Cairo and used these recorded materials as the ingredients for his composition. Again, not writing notes on paper to compose music, but working with the sound directly. Eldab's work and Musique Concrète out of France is of course all analog, as is an early kind of sampling instrument, the mellotron. There are lots of notable digital samplers, including the Synclavier, the Akai MPC, the Fairlight, and even the Super Nintendo uses sampling synthesis for its game music. Looking at a contemporary software sampler, here's a sampled piano in Contact. This instrument has a whole bunch of samples for each of the 88 keys. There are 18 different samples for velocities, and there are even separate samples for key releases. That's a lot of storage. Now, instead of having all these samples, I could take another route and use just one sample for the whole piano. What happens inside this digital synthesizer then is that the sample is played back at different speeds. It's resampled in order to change the pitch. We can certainly say that some of the realism of this piano has been compromised, but our goal with synthesis doesn't have to be the recreation of reality, and I might even argue that our goal should be the opposite. Anyway, these are two different extremes, thousands of samples versus one sample. And there are middle grounds too, like sampling 10 keys of the piano and then assigning them to different ranges, etc. All right, so we can take samples and change how fast we play them to change their pitch. Let's take that a step further. What if I were to take my sample then, and instead of playing back the entire file, I just select a small part of the waveform, a single cycle, and then I play that at a loop. Still, I can adjust the speed I play this back at and change the pitch. At this point, this is no longer sample-based synthesis. What I'm doing now is wavetable synthesis. We're cycling an arbitrary periodic waveform. We're taking one cycle of that waveform and looping it to create a sustained pitch. In synthesis systems, we accomplish this with a generator module called an oscillator. Oscillators allow us to play back periodic waveforms. This is in contrast to a sampler, which lets us trigger non-periodic waveforms, lets us trigger those samples. Now, since we only have a very, very small part of that sample, we're taking up significantly less storage. That said, in order to give this oscillator some more sophistication, we're likely going to have to add some more processing to do so. Massive is an example of a wavetable synthesizer. Inside of Massive, there are a whole bunch of wavetables, and in Massive's controls, it lets you crossfade between two wavetables at a time. This gives you a lot of variety in what you can do with your oscillators. Here's something that I put together in Reactor. I can play this synthesizer. And you can see that what's happening is this is my wavetable, and this oscilloscope is showing us the output. Not terribly interesting, but I can change this in real time. Again, the output waveform is affected by the wavetable that I'm drawing, and we can hear the difference in sound too. We can hear all those harmonics get added as we make it more spiky. These are two synthesis techniques that you'll encounter quite a bit. Just to remind ourselves, samplers take up a lot of memory. Wavetables, which are very short, don't take up much memory, but they don't immediately give us dynamic and sophisticated sounds. In sample-based synthesis, we're using samplers to play back non-periodic waveforms. And in wavetable synthesis, we're using an oscillator to play back an arbitrary periodic waveform.